Now, will you listen to him here? Verse 21, "Fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things." The tribulation period is going to lead to the coming of Christ to the earth to establish his kingdom. Now, the church is not in this picture. It's not in the Olivet Discourse. And the church is not in Revelation when you begin chapter 4. You see a group carried to heaven, and the church is no longer on the earth. And somebody says, well, it's not called a church. Well, when the church gets out of the world and gets to heaven, it's not a church. You say, what do you mean? Well, church is ecclesia, that's called out. And God is calling out a people today to his name. When they get to heaven, they've already been called out. They're no longer a church. They're the bride of Christ. The figure changes in the book of Revelation. Fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice. Now, the land today is under a curse. They may be back in that land, but the curse is not removed from the land. They need water over there. And anybody that's driven down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and I've made that trip, I know a dozen times, my friend, if anybody can call that the Garden of Eden, and anybody can say the desert is blossoming like the rose, that's not my idea of it. That's as desolate as anything that's in Arizona or California. Our desert is not any more desolate than that. Now, will you notice, verse 22, "Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring, for the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength." That day hasn't come yet. Verse 23, "Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord." Now, who is he talking to? The church? Please, friends, let God speak to who he wants to speak to. And the interpretation is to the southern kingdom, to the children of Zion. And I may sing lustily, "I'm marching to Zion," but I'm not marching to Zion down here on the earth. "Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month." Now, let's look at that for just a moment. I believe that we're still talking about literal things here. And we're talking about literal rain is referred to here. Now, Joel will make application of it in the pouring out of the Holy Spirit, which we'll be coming to. But literal rain is referred to here. The former rain came in October, the latter rain in April. And I heard before I went over to that land that the latter rain was returning to that land. Well, I've been over there in April, and it rained a little. But gracious, I don't think you could call that kind of a rain that the Lord's talking about and that they had in the former days when that entire land, all those rugged hills, were covered with trees. Of course, the enemies that have come in have denuded the land, and they're trying to set out trees. But they're having trouble to make those trees grow today because there's not enough of the latter rain. Now, that has not come, and there's a great many references to the literal rain. And I'm not going to take time today to go into that. You have Leviticus, and in my notes I give all the references, Leviticus 26, 3 and 4, passage in Deuteronomy, 1 Kings, Jeremiah, and Hosea. These references make it clear that this passage, I think, cannot be spiritualized, but it refers to literal rain. Now, you can make application of it, of course, if you want to. But let's understand that he's speaking to the children of Zion, and he's speaking about rain in that country, H2O, aqua, hudor, that comes down from heaven. We call it water, rainwater. That's what he's talking about. And it's not coming down today, but it will in the future.